Dear students, let us consider another application of dummy variables, namely piecewise linear regression. Piecewise linear regression. To explain piecewise linear regression, consider a company giving remuneration to its sales representatives. Sales on the x-axis, commission on the y-axis. As you can see, the company pays remuneration in such a way that up to a level, say X star, known as threshold, up to X star, known as threshold or target. It pays commission at one rate. Beyond that, that is, once the sales go beyond this target or threshold, it pays commission at a different rate. Both segments are linear, that is, but the slopes are different. For the first, there is a slope, that is the commission rate. Beyond that, another. So specifically, we say that commission increases linearly up to X star. Beyond that also, it increases linearly, but with a steeper slope. That is, the commission rate increases beyond X star. So we have what is known as a piecewise linear regression. We have two pieces for one, two pieces one and two, but both pieces are linear. Now we have to test whether there is a piecewise regression or not. We can test it if we have value on commission is a variable, sales a variable, and X star the threshold or target, also known as Not means known in advance. Now, commission is a variable, sales is also a variable, X star is not a variable, it is a particular value only. Say, for example, X star is, say, equal to 5000, something like that. So, if you have data on commission, data on sales, and if you know the value of X star, the threshold, the target, the X star, then you can test the possibility of piecewise regression. To test it, assuming that X star is known, we run this regression. Yi is equal to alpha 1 plus beta 1 X I plus beta 2 X I minus X star into DI plus UI, where YI is sales commission, X star, as I told you, is the threshold value, also known as not, And D, why is commission exercise excess of threshold? And D is equal to 1 if x is greater than x star. If x is greater than x star and equal to 0 if x is less than x star. Now, assuming that all the assumptions of the classical linear regression model are satisfied, we have expected y given x, di is equal to 0. Di is equal to 0 means up to the threshold x star equal to alpha 1 plus beta 1 xi, because d is 0. Now, if you expand this term, beta to xi di plus beta to x star di, di is 1, beta to xi, sorry, minus beta to x star. If you expand this term, it is like this. Now, if expected y given x, d is equal to 1 is alpha 1 plus beta 1 plus, sorry, not alpha 1 plus beta 1, alpha 1 minus beta 2 x star plus beta 1 plus beta 2 xi. Alpha 1 minus beta 2 x star, the intercepts, and the slope is beta 1 plus beta 2 xi, beta 1 plus beta 2 xi, because d is equal to 1, beta 1 plus beta 2 x common, d is equal to 1. So we run this regression, and if beta 2 is significant, if beta 2 is, we are testing for whether there is a difference in the slope up to x star and also beyond x star. So if beta 2 is significant, the slope of the regression after x star is beta 1 plus beta 2. Below that, it is only beta 1. And this is the intercept only. If you extend this, the intercept will be alpha 1 minus beta 2 x star. And intercept of this is alpha 1. Intercept of the second is this. Slope of the second is beta 1 plus beta 2. Slope of the first is equal to beta 1, that is. So to run this regression, you must know y, x and also x star. For that, you plot the regression, I mean the scatter plot, and to see whether there is such a change in the slope after a certain level, etc. And we test the hypothesis that h0, beta 2 is equal to 0 versus h1, beta 2 not equal to 0. If beta 2 is not equal to 0, then we will say that this is a case of piecewise regression. Actually, piecewise regression is an example of a more general class of functions known as spline functions. Spline functions. We can test for the possibility of one structural change, more than one structural change, any number of structural change by formulating the model. And remember this, when you construct the data y, x, then x minus x star into d. These are the variables. So y, y1, y2, x, x1, x. Then if x star is 5000, for the value of D equal to 0, these are all 0 values. Then 1, it is 1, x minus x star, that is the value of x minus x star into D. If x is 10,000 as an example, one observation, minus 5,000, you will get 5,000 here. Like that, because D is equal to 1. So the data should be constructed like this, and you regress y on x, and the data constructed x minus x star into D. This is the procedure. This is how we test for what is known as piecewise linear regression. Now let me consider one more example, namely how to interpret dummy variables in semi-log regression models. In semi-log regression models, how to interpret regression in semi-log regression models or log linear models we have studied earlier, semi-log. Now we know that if our model is Ly is equal to beta 1 plus beta 2 x plus u, this is a semi-log model, and we have specified it as log linear model. And the interpretation of beta 2 is the percentage change in y for a unit change in x. We have discussed this model extensively in the context of estimating growth rates, where x was t. Where if time increases by 1 unit, 1 year, 1 month, etc., beta 2 measures the growth rate of y. The proportionate change multiplied by 100 will give you percentage change. So 100 into beta 2 is percentage change in y. That is the interpretation. And in this model, slope we have interpreted it as beta 2 into y. That is the slope of the model. Elasticity was beta 2 into x. Elasticity was beta 2 into x. We have studied this model extensively. To refresh your memory, just to go back. So here, when x changes by 1 unit, absolute change in x causes relative change in y. Multiplied by 100 will give you percentage change in y. Now, what will be the interpretation if x is a dummy variable? Now, ln y is equal to beta 1 plus beta 2 di plus ui. Dependent variable is ln y. Independent variable is a dummy variable. Say, for example, y is hourly wage is taken as hourly wage as usual in log form d to 1 male is equal to 0 if female, suppose. If it is y, it is simply the usual interpretation, and we are testing for the possibility of whether there is discrimination. Now, the difference is hourly wage is specified in log form. Log form. Beta 1 is the, if it is not in log form, beta 1 is the mean wage of female, and beta 1 plus beta 2 is the mean wage of male. And if beta 2 is significant, we will say that the average wage of male is greater than that of female. Now, beta 1 in this specification is the mean log hourly earnings, and slope coefficient gives the difference in the mean log hourly base. Beta 1 here is, beta 1 here is the യൂഷ്വൽ ഇൻ്റർസെപ്റ്റ്സ് മീൻ അവർലി, നോട്ട് സിംപ്ലി മീൻ അവർലി, മീൻ ലോഗ് അവർലി ഏർണിങ്സ് ആൻഡ് ബീറ്റ ടു ഈസ് ദ ഡിഫറൻഷ്യൽ ഇൻ്റർസെപ്റ്റ്സ്, ദറ്റ് ഈസ് ദ ഡിഫറൻസ് ഇൻ ദി മീൻ ലോഗ് അവർലി ഏർണിംഗ് ഓഫ് മെയിൽ മീൻ അവർലി ഏർണിങ്സ്. സോ ബീറ്റ വൺ ഈസ് ദ മീൻ മീൻ ലോഗ് അവർലി ഏർണിങ്സ് ഓഫ് ഫീമെയിൽ, ബീറ്റ ടു ഈസ് ദ ഡിഫറൻസ് ഇൻ ദ മീൻ ലോഗ് അവർലി ഏർണിങ്സ്. ദിസ് ഇൻ്റർപ്രട്ടേഷൻ ഈസ് ഓക്വേർഡ്. ദിസ് ഇൻ്റർപ്രട്ടേഷൻ ഈസ് ഓക്വേർഡ്. വി ഡു നോട്ട് നോ ഹൗ ടു ഇൻ്റർപ്രട്ട് ഇറ്റ്, ഇറ്റ് ഈസ് ഓക്വേർഡ്. സോ വാട്ട് വി ഡു ഈസ് ഇഫ് യു ടേക്ക് ദ ആൻറ്റി ലോഗ് ഓഫ് ബീറ്റ വൺ, ആൻറ്റി ലോഗ് ഓഫ് ബീറ്റ വൺ, ഇഫ് യു ടേക്ക് ദ ആൻറ്റി ലോഗ് ഓഫ് ബീറ്റ വൺ, യു വി വിൽ ഗെറ്റ് ദ മീഡിയൻ വെയ്റ്റ്സ് ഓഫ് ഫീമെയിൽ, മീഡിയൻ വെയ്റ്റ്സ് ആൻഡ് ആൻറ്റി ലോഗ് ഓഫ് ബീറ്റ വൺ പ്ലസ് ബീറ്റ ടു ഈസ് ദ മീഡിയൻ അവർലി വേജ് ഓഫ് മെയിൽ വർക്കേഴ്സ്, ദ മീഡിയൻ അവർലി വേജ് ഓഫ് മെയിൽ. സോ ടേക്ക് ആൻറ്റി ലോഗ് ഓഫ് ബീറ്റ വൺ, മീഡിയൻ വേജ് ഓഫ് ഫീമെയിൽ, ടേക്ക് ആൻറ്റി ലോഗ് ഓഫ് ബീറ്റ വൺ പ്ലസ് ബീറ്റ ടു, യു വിൽ ഗെറ്റ് ദ മീഡിയൻ അവർലി മീഡിയൻ വേജ് ഓഫ് മെയിൽ. സോ ദിസ് ഈസ് ദ ഇൻ്റർപ്രട്ടേഷൻ ഓഫ് ദ മോഡൽ ഇൻ വിച്ച് ദ ഡിപ്പെൻഡൻറ്റ് വേരിയബിൾ ഈസ് ലോഗ്, ഇൻഡിപ്പെൻഡൻറ്റ് വേരിയബിൾ ഈസ് എ ഡമ്മി വേരിയബിൾ. So keep it in mind if you are specifying the dependent variable in log form. Otherwise, the usual interpretation as x changes by one unit, y, the this ln y, the proportionate change in y, that is beta 2, multiplied by 100 will give you percentage change. Slope is this, elasticity is this. The problem only when the independent variable is a dummy variable. Keep it in mind. Let me consider one more example. That is, suppose that we want to estimate the effect of credit rating CR, credit rating on what is known as the bond interest rates, bond interest rates, credit rating. Remember this, credit rating determines the bond interest rates, and this bond interest rate is the usual rate of interest, 1%, 2%, 3%, 4%, 5%, etc. Credit rating is in a scale between 0 and 5. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. 1 in a 0, 4, up to 4. The best performance is 4. The worst performance is 0. And remember this, the relation between these two is negative. That means, as the credit rating increases, bond interest rate of the government or a local body, whatever it is, decreases. That is, the relation is inverse. The bond interest rate, that is the dependent variable, the usual quantitative variable. So you can run BIR as equal to beta 1 plus beta 2, credit rating plus other factors, bond interest rate 1%, 2, 3, 4, 5, etc., quantitative variable, and beta 2 measures the percentage point change. Not the percentage change, the percentage point change. say 2% become 1% become 2%, 3%, etc. As credit rating increases by 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. The problem here is dependent variable Y is 1%, 2%, 3%, 4%, 5%, etc. Credit rating is 0, 1. For some local bodies, it will be 1, 4, 0, 2, etc. But the problem is credit rating is an ordinal variable, not a ratio scale, quantitative variable. So we cannot give a meaningful interpretation to credit rating as in the case of quantitative regressives. In the case of quantitative regressives, the difference between 1 and 2 and 2 and 3 is same. But in the case of credit rating, the difference between 0 and 1 need not be equal to between 2 and 3. Credit rating is different. So the question is, what to do? If the independent variable is ordinal scale variable, but remember this, there are many cases in which we will collect data using a Likert scale. If you collect data using a Likert scale, you will give values from say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, etc. 7-point scale, 5-point scale, etc. These are ordinal data, cannot give a meaningful interpretation like quantitative data. But there are many papers available in the internet stating that ordinal scale variables, ordinal data can be treated like a quantitative data. That is another issue. So we can use it as quantitative data also, no problem. But what I am saying is, it will be more convenient, more meaningful, if we use dummies for credit rating like this. Bond interest rate is equal to beta 1 plus beta 2. Rating is from 0 to 4, D2 plus beta 3, D3 plus beta 4, D4 plus beta 5, D5 plus U with the D2, 1 if the rating is 1, 0 otherwise. D3 is 1 if the rating is 2, 0 otherwise. So the base category is rating with 0 rate. So we can represent this ordinal data using 4 dummies, because this rating, credit rating, the qualitative variable has 5 categories. So remember this. If your data is ordinal data, you can again use dummy variables. You can use numbers also, but it is better to use these dummies. Initially, we have used dummies to represent qualitative variables, but dummies can also be used to represent ordinal variables. That is the point. So these are the uses of dummy variables. And remember this, whenever we use a regression analysis, qualitative variables play a very important role in the relationship between regressors and regressants. And if qualitative variables are important, these qualitative variables must be introduced. The procedure for introducing qualitative variables is dummy variables. And remember this, we can introduce dummies in additive form, multiplicative form, and also interactive interaction between. That is, we can test for differences in intercept, differences in slope, and also interaction between two qualitative variables. Dummy variables can also be used to represent ordinal variables, even though there are many papers stating that ordinal variables can be treated as quantitative variables. That is another point. So our discussion of dummy variables is complete.